Hi, this is Mama Shan with another tutorial in the green screen series. And I know in the last video that we've already extracted the image and applied a layer mask to it, but I want to go over some other finessing techniques and to show you what happens when you select this image using the wand tool at a lower tolerance setting. So I'm going to do that right now and select the magic wand tool, which is right here in CS3. And instead of using a tolerance of 64, I'm going to use a tolerance of 30. And I'm going to make sure the first little icon to create a new selection is highlighted, and just click in the green area. And then I'm going to hold my shift key down and click in these other areas, still holding shift down, still holding shift down. And then I'm going to spacebar control key or spacebar command on a Mac and zoom into this area, hold the shift key down. Because if you don't hold that shift key down when you have this icon selected, it will deselect the other areas and just select the new area you're adding to an existing selection. So again, we're going to double click on the background. I'm just going to call this layer 1. Click OK. And then I'm going to Alt or Option click on the mask icon at the bottom of the layers palette to add that mask. And we're going to do a slip layer real quickly. Going over to the Create Fill Adjust icon at the bottom and choose Solid Color. When the color picker opens up, I'm going to choose a reddish color and drag the slip layer underneath. Now, at a lower tolerance setting, if you compare this with the last video, and I get this question a lot where people say, I've made a selection, but there's still that edge around it. Well, that edge is around it because I chose a lower tolerance setting. So initially selecting a tolerance setting that gets close enough in, it helps out. But there are some things that you can do to the mask directly that can suck this mask in closer to the image. If it's pretty even all the way around, which it looks like it is, and let me zoom in a little bit further, and you can see that there's a lot more edge showing up around this image than there was when we selected it with a tolerance of 64. But we're going to do some mask editing, and these techniques work in all versions of Photoshop since version 4. There are some new tools in CS3 for refining a selection, but I'm going to show you the old way because it works in all versions, and then in another tutorial at some point I'll show you how to use the refine selection, which basically is in the background employing some of these basic techniques that I'm showing you today. So highlight the mask right here, so that it says layer mask. And I want you to have an understanding of the black and the white. And I'm just going to alt click on here to bring the big picture of the mask into the main window here. And I'm going to select the move tool because I don't want to accidentally create a selection if I click there. The white area here is the selected area. This is the area that is being revealed, and the black is the mask. It's masking that background out. And there's a command in Photoshop under the filter menu, under the other category. There's two of them. One is called maximum and one is called minimum. And I used to be very confused to remember which one is which in this one. And how you can remember it is it's referring to the white area. It's referring to that light area. If you want a maximum amount of that white area, if you want to add to it, increase the selection, you would choose maximum here. And you can fine-tune that in increments of single pixels. Minimum would mean that you want to shrink the white area. And so that would be making the revealed area a little bit less. And isn't that what we want to do here? Okay. So I'm just going to come back out here and Alt or Option click on the mask to show the picture again. Using these thumbnails as reference is helpful we can see that the white area is revealing a little bit too much of the background, which is still there. Shift click. That is not deleted. It's still there. Shift click on the mask to turn it off for a minute. Shift click on it again to turn it back on. So since we're seeing that green fringe around it, we need to minimize the white area, the reveal area. We want that to be a little bit smaller. So with the mask highlighted, we're going to come in here to filter, other, and minimum. And when the minimum dialog box opens up, notice how, and I hope you can see this in the video, I'm going to zoom in to this edge here and shut the preview off. It's off now. Now when we add that radius of just one pixel in the other minimum filter box, see how it just sucks right in closer to the area. Now if we go up higher, it's going to start sucking away a lot of the image. So usually in this box, we are only implementing a 1 or 2 radius. Again, it depends on that initial tolerance that you set for the selection. So what I'm going to do is leave that at 1. And we still have still a little bit of fringe. But if we go back to filter other and minimum again and do another 1, it seems like, well, we'll look around here. I'm going to use my space bar. That lets me move around. It's not too bad, actually. It's a little rough, but not too bad. But it's sucked away. We still have to do some manual cleanup on some parts, but I'm just looking here. And I'm going to check the preview on and off. Really is doing a good job coming in there a second time. Okay, I'm going to do that and click OK. And now it still needs to be a little bit smoother around the edges, maybe so that it will blend in, although it is pretty darn smooth. Here's another thing that we can do to the mask, and this involves using another filter, and it's called Gaussian Blur. So go under Blur and Gaussian Blur. And again, make sure that mask is the part you have highlighted. Also, I would like to mention, sometimes, not always, even though we are on the mask, sometimes when we go to some of these filters, like the blur filter, and I don't know if it's a glitch in my Photoshop, but sometimes it adds a little blur to the image too when it's not supposed to. But if you click this chain link in between the two, that really separates them. And let me show you what I mean by separates them. If I have first, let me link that again. And when it's linked like that, when I move the image, the mask moves with it. So the mask is always around the image no matter where I move it. Okay, so it's linked. They are one. Now, if I unlink the two of these and I have the mask selected and I move, it's moving the mask. I'm going to undo that with a Control-Z on a PC, Command-Z on a Macintosh. If I highlight the thumbnail of the image and move it when it's unlinked, then the image is moving behind the mask. And that's something cool to know because you might be able to do something creative with that as well. I'm going to undo that again, Control-Z, PC, Command-Z, Macintosh. And so one thing to remember is after we do the blur filter and some other things on the mask, link it up again because it should only be unlinked temporarily. So I'm going to highlight the mask and let's zoom in on the edges a bit, and particularly around the face. And I'm going to zoom in at a ratio of 100%. Notice when I do a command minus here at 66.67, this odd amount, things look a little jaggy. And again, that is because it's a cache view. for accuracy purposes, when you are editing, you should look at even multiples of 100. So looking at it at 50 would be better than 66. Looking at it 100%, even better. So, all right, we'll go to Filter, Blur, and I'll go to the Gaussian Blur command. And just with a 1 pixel amount, you can see that that has smoothed up that edge quite a bit and looks very nice, just like this. So we've created a really nice mask, even starting out with a lower tolerance amount. And it might even be a better mask. And I'm going to click OK. Just blurring that edge a teeny tiny bit. Now, if you wanted to add more sharpness or clarity back to that mask, or reveal or conceal a little bit more of the image, here's another menu command for image adjustments that you're used to using for correcting exposure and color and contrast in Photoshop, but it is also a terrific tool to use in masking on the mask directly. So again, make sure the mask thumbnail is highlighted. It says layer mask up here, and directly go to image adjustments and levels. This is applying it directly to the mask. We're not using adjustment layers here. We're using this adjustment directly on that 8-bit channel mask. And when you come in here, I'm going to try to move this up so that you can see the edges as well. And I'm going to zoom in, say at 200% here, and move this over. Where'd my levels go? Did it disappear? Okay, let me do it again. Image adjustments, levels. Okay. Now, as you know, in exposure and just general image correction, to increase contrast in the levels dialog box, it's a process of moving the black point slider and the white point slider towards each other. So again, these are representative. Think in terms of the mask. The black is controlling the black area of the mask itself. The white point slider is controlling the white area. So if I were to move the white point slider over quite a bit, it's going to give me more white area, like the maximum filter would do in others. See how the green fringe has showed up again? Conversely, moving the black point slider is going to suck it in some more. I'm exaggerating this just so you know how it works. You can see we're losing some stuff here. And you can also use the midpoint slider, and moving it to the left is going to increase the white areas. You can start to see that by increasing the white area, that is the revealed area. And you can see some of that green showing through. Moving it to the right is going to suck it in a bit too. So I don't think we need to change anything. I just wanted to show you that this is another tool and how to use it when you're trying to refine the edges of your masks. I'm just going to hit cancel out of here and come back like this. Now I'm looking at this image, and again, this is about making a perfect selection, and I see some areas where I'm going to have to put back, and I'll shift click on this mask, and there's a little bit of that earring that needs to come back. The rest of it looks good. I'm actually going to change this color here to a gray with a little bit of a red tint to it. And I'm going to lock that mask again, just so that I don't, or link it rather, to the thumbnail. Okay, and selecting a brush to finesse this area that I want to bring back. I don't want an airbrush, and I don't want 100% hardness in the brush. And the reason why is because I've already made this edge. I'm going to alt-click on it so you can see where it's got a little bit of smoothness to it. It's not totally feathered out like an airbrush would do, but it's not totally hard either. So this is where a little bit of trial and error comes in. I'm going to click the brush tool and then come up here and select a hard round brush, But then what I'm going to do is adjust the hardness here. I'm going to start out with just giving it 50% hardness. Now, if I had it all the way down to zero, it would be feathered out quite a bit, like an airbrush. But what I want is a little bit of smoothness, so I'm just going to start out with a 50% hardness and see how that works. And click out here, and then make my, since it is round, I'm going to use that. I need to switch that foreground to white, because what I want to do is reveal a little bit more of that earring right here. I want the edge to mesh with the existing edge that has been created with those other mesh methods, and that seems to work pretty well. It looks pretty good. And I'm going to shift click on this just to look at the image over here. And I think I need to add a little bit more here. And let me come back in history and see over here. It looks a little too soft to me. So let me come back in history to my brush tool and back here and make it a little harder. Maybe go up to 75. Hit X, clean up. I'm just using the very edge of that diameter, the outside diameter of the brush, to just kind of clean up. And this indeed has made another pretty good selection. Down here, I'm going to clean this up just with the very outside edge of that brush. I'm going to click release, move the position of my brush without holding down the mouse button, and then I'll hold my shift key down and click, and it kind of snaps to it. So if you have shaky hands, this is a great method to clean up an edge. It's like you're just going in little steps and it's following behind with that shift click. Ah, there's something happened down here. That must have happened when I had it moving around. So I'm just going to get rid of, you don't see these things if you're not zoomed in. So I can't emphasize strongly enough that when you are trying to do perfect extractions, you have to use your navigational shortcuts, zooming in, look at it close up, and look at it far back too. I'll just quickly go over here like that, because I know if it was on that side, it's got to be on this side too. And I'm just using that shift click method. And this is here only because I was showing you how to separate the mask and the image and moving it around. So if you're playing around like that, you may have to do this as well. And if you're going straight up, another method besides shift click, if you start out with your shift key held down and move your mouse up, keeping that held down, it doesn't matter where your cursor is going, it's going to move at that angle, 90 degree angle. It does 90 degree angles and 180 degree angles. You just start the direction off. All right, now control minus on a PC, command minus on a Mac, and we've got another excellent extraction here. Now if I want this to fit in the window again, I'm just going to get my move tool and I'm just going to move this down to the edge. And I can kind of look at that thumbnail and see that I need to move it to the right a little bit, so I'm just going to use my right arrow key until that updates in the layer thumbnail, so I'm not seeing the checkerboards, so it's back to that original position. And again, just quickly going over the clipping mask technique. You just create a new layer, a new blank layer, and I showed you the shortcut of holding down the Alt or Option key in between the two layers and then clicking. You can also find the layer command to group, create this clipping mask under layer, create clipping mask. And note the shortcut is Alt-Control-G. And that will create a clipping mask and it will undo a clipping mask if you hit that again. So that also creates that. Get my brush tool, change the blending mode, most importantly to you. And this time I will get a nice airbrush. Zoom in. Alt click on a skin color without the cast, and then just start painting over it like this. I'm going to undo that one and maybe make the opacity a little bit less on my brush. Alt click. Note that foreground color swatch over here is changing a little bit when I make those samples by Alt or Option clicking. That gets that cast out really nicely. And again, around the shirt, make sure you're sampling the shirt color if you're trying to cancel out the cast here. Skin color for the arm. Then we've got clothing here, so be careful what you do on this edge. And again, for the watch, because that is a silver, the easiest way is to hit D. And you can paint with black or white on this. Either one will neutralize. I think in the last video I used black, but I'll just hit X and show you that it works with white as well. Let's get that 100%. Yeah. See how that's just making it very silver. And then to clean this one up, there's some overspray here, and I'm going to zoom in to show you that, that's spilling over. Get the eraser tool, and to clean up the spill pretty well, you want it at 100%. I'm just going to do my shift clicking around where it's spilled onto the skin. It's clicking around here like that. And then if you want to back off on the neutrality or grayness of it on the watch here to bring back some of that original color, teeny bit of cast, take your opacity of your eraser tool and bring that down to about 20. And we can just make that really big, because we're doing erasing, and then just click a couple times to bring a little of that back. I'm going to Control Z on that last one because that really brought back a little bit too much of that gray. But I am going to go in here with the eraser tool and get that little bit of gray. Then go back to your brush and continue around with the method for cleaning up the green cast.